Again, two spots on these feathers, however, one side of the feather is covered by the one on top of it, so you don't get to see. Sometimes there's a little sliver like there. Next row. Feathers get a little more elongated rather, or spots get a little more elongated on the wing feathers than they are on the side pockets and scapulars. There'll be quills painted into these as well. So again, I'm just laying in these spots. And we'll be coming back and defining them more at a later date. So I want to get things laid in here right now. To the other side. Thank you. I'm just kind of matching up the other side. Can't do this too much because it'll take off the paint below, but I don't like these higher spots on here. I took them off. All right, adjustments made. I like that much better. Okay, now do the legs. Tops of the legs. Laurie is pulled away out of camera. Okay, just a few more feathers here. Thank you. Or even laid in these spots. This loon just looked like kind of a silhouette, as my husband Jeff described it. And he was exactly right. Now it's starting to come into focus. With these spots being added. That's kind of cool. It's been waiting for spots for a long time. Use your finger to dab it off if it's a little bit too intense. And one of the advantages of designing your own patterns is the intimate knowledge you have of your design. You don't have that with somebody else's pattern. You're trying to interpret what they see into something you can see, where if you've designed your own pattern, it's always been in your sight. It's you. It's not somebody else, it's you. And I think that's one of the biggest lessons to be learned. Is the advantage you have when you design your own patterns. Nobody else has your pattern, right? You're not going to see another person who uses Pat Godden or a Bruce Burke or a Gordon Stiller or whoever. A lot of pattern makers out there, but you can be your own pattern maker. I bought my book. It tells you exactly how. written several articles on it. Trying to stress the advantages. So consider being original. Don't be a copycat. You know, I see a lot of guys doing decoys in the style of this guy or that guy. Why are they doing that? Why are they not doing decoys in the style of themselves? Do they not have enough faith? It is scary to step out of the boat, stand on your own. But the rewards are much greater. And nobody else is going to have what you have when you design your own. And I think I'll leave off here. And I'll see you all at the next sitting. We're getting close to finishing this forever loon. And zoom out. It's amazing what a few spots can do. See you next time. Thanks for watching. Well, good morning. It is June 28th, and I left off at the tail yesterday because I had to attend a meeting. So, I am going to finish off the spots on this tail, and then we're going to move on to some of the head detail. When I stop for the night, I will take a second custard cup, which is a glass custard cup, and cover up my medium, and that gives it some a couple days, but alright, a bit more paint. I only have about 20-30 spots to finish off on these tail feathers. And that's just, we're just laying, excuse me, we're just laying in the spots. So the subsequent passes will give me the opportunity to clean these up, adjust their shape, their size, maybe a little bit of their placement. Well, this is not a competitive piece, and so I won't be taking it to competitive level, but at least by my own standards, some people may consider it competitive level. I raise the bar for myself whenever I can. Because one day I won't be able to. When you're painting in oils, if you can use, at least for me, you can use, you know, several thin coats, passes. I think you're going to have a softer look than one or two passes. That's always been my experience. Just checking to see if there's anything I've missed here. It all looks pretty good. All right. Well, as I said before, I was surprised by the color of the paint that I got when I mixed the Japan oil tempera fast drying paints, which I don't know that I'll ever use them again. They're terribly messy, and the color isn't as true as I thought it would be. So what I'm gonna do is come back with the same dark spam. So I'm going to use the same dark brown that I used earlier on the body. Scraping off the dried paint. Left over from when I used it before. So now when you peel off this skin, going to expose the dark paint that I want for this part of my project. And quite honestly, so I'm going to use that same small brush that I was using earlier. And there's some residue of the white paint that I was using that's on the bottom of the medium, so I'm not going to go deep into that to avoid muddying up my medium. I'm trying to conserve it. So I'm gonna quick draw paint. Zoom in a little bit here. and take care of the in-betweens on the necklace and the neck patches. Before I start feathering out the rest of the head. Again, this white was just laid in as a base coat. And making sure everything's in focus here for the video. Now these deep dark areas in between the feather tracks on the necklace and breast feathers, actually, are two feather tracks of feathers that are colliding. At the base of the feather, it's black, and at the tips of the feather, it's kind of a tassel-y textured white. And when the two feather tracks collide, they push out and create ridges. So it is a totally different feather group. I'm just kind of shaping the bottom edges of the overpainted areas. Sometimes the feather tracks get messed up and you can see a Y instead of a stripe. I think I incorporated that on this loom. But it's quite common. I'll be coming back with white, of course, so don't panic when you're doing this if you overpaint onto the white. It's a back and forth process in painting, and you have to be patient. The first time you might not hit it exactly, and then the second time you will. So going back and forth gives you the opportunity to be more accurate by giving you more passes, which softens anything up. This is a hard area to get into and still make it possible for the camera to see what I'm doing. Kind of like standing on my head to get in there. It happens in carving and in painting. I like to get a little bit of a puddle going on my palette so I can come back and just easily dip my brush without having to One of the best practices when you're painting is to not mix your colors with your brush. It'll just wear your brush out. There, but I'm not going to panic. And then on the back side. I overpainted with the white under the head, so I'm going to come back, clean that up. So there's a big difference now between this side, get the frame here, focus, this side, and then if I flip it over and show you the other, you know, there's no, it's shadow if you see any darkness in between. So now I'm going to come back and do the other side, which may be more visible to you than the other first side was. Get my little puddle set up. No. Same thing on the back side of that last row. I'm cleaning up the overpaint from the first pass of white. I find myself holding my breath when I'm doing this kind of work. It helps me to keep me steady. And it's why I don't talk. I don't speak that much while I'm doing fine work like this. After I do this, I'm going to do the breast again and bring some of that the dark up into the breast. And each time I do something like this, it just brings this bird into focus a little bit more. It's kind of blurry right now. For the spots, it looked like a silhouette. Now the spots are there, and it's like, okay. It's also a bit of skill in holding this project so that you can see what I'm doing. here we go. Clean up. Around the patch. I'm not worrying about the black showing on the gray blue. It will be of no consequence after I start feathering out the head. Just want to get the shape of the neck patch down. It's still kind of messy, but again, with each pass, it's going to become cleaner and neater and more precise. So, not sure if I'm going to be able to make it so that you can see me cleaning up the, doing the same thing for the breast. I'm going to try my best. It's kind of frustrating. So I have to have it at a certain position to be able to paint it and see it myself, and to make that happen for the viewers of this video, it's definitely a challenge. And don't expect it's going to happen on the first stroke. Sometimes it takes a few strokes to get that paint going, flowing off of your paintbrush. If you're trying not to have too much on the paintbrush to begin with, because a lot of times it'll run all over your carving, and that's not good at all. So I'm going to go down the in-betweens of these feather tracks first, and then I'll come back and clean up the shape of the top of the feather tract when I've got the rest of it done. So, this paint that's in this palette lasted with another pie plate on top of it since January 15th. I just peeled back a skin that had formed, and I was able to get right back into the same color that I was using before, and not have to remix it and hope I'm mixing it correctly. Not that this is a difficult color to mix either, but it's just convenient to not have to mix each time you sit down, which is different than acrylic. You've got to, unless you've got a stay wet palette, which I actually do have, you're subject to having to mix your colors each sitting. Stay wet palette on acrylics allows you to keep your paint, same mix, same piles of paint that you've mixed on your palette for months on end. If you just keep the palette wet, from it keeps everything moist from below in a foam pad and some special paper. And when you get some overpaint onto the white, don't worry about that, because that's going to actually be helpful in defining the feather flow that you'll be painting in on these feather tracks, or at least that I'll be painting in. A lot of people don't get that far before they quit. But there is definite feather flow going from the dark feather tract centers to the center of the white outer edges that are colliding to create the ridges on the loom. Loom breast, loom side pockets. I'm sorry, loom side patches on the neck, not side pockets. Silly goose. It's hard to, you know, you can't paint white on white, so your overpainting in this case will lend itself. And you can come back and, if it's really bad, and clean it up with a clean brush and some medium if necessary. Okay, shows you the definition of the other side where I haven't done it, and you don't really see that yet. So, that's what I'll be doing next. Working on the front, which I really don't think you're going to be able to see. I'll try. We'll be able to see it. Well, be sure and take your line all the way down to where you've carved, because that's important. It was carved this way on purpose. you know, the way I hold this for the camera isn't necessarily the way I'd do it if nobody was watching. Just because it's difficult to hold it into view and see it myself, for myself. Now I can come back with some clean brush and clean off any over paint that bothers me. There's just a couple of places that it was really quite difficult to hold things steady. So I'm cleaning it up just a little bit. Right there. Use a softer brush here. This is more of the slant tip that's a little bit worn down. Some of this was over paint from when I did the brown, so it's not going to wipe off like the black is, or really dark brown is, but it's worth going back and just cleaning certain things up so you don't have to deal with it later. When you wipe off the the dark, you need to come and wipe your brush off to get the paint out of it, so you're not just pushing paint. I would come back the same way on my acrylic painting as I'm doing right now, just with the water instead of medium to clean up. Check this side, and then I'm going to work on the necklace a little bit. It's kind of sloppy. Nope, this isn't the necklace. This is the neck patch. The necklace is under the chin area. Not that they have chins, loons. I said I was going to take care of the top edge. Just make it nice and round. Now I'm going to clean up this necklace. I'm going to use the same black, or dark brown is what it is actually, to lay in the feather flow of the head. I'm going to use a relatively newer Kolinsky sable because it will have nice point to it. It will hold the paint. I'll zoom in and show you. This is the Raphael number 3, 8408. And this nice brush holds a lot of paint, so I don't have to keep going back and forth from my palette to my project.